So Winfrey Church, we know you're probably sitting on your couch at home right now, but this is a really fun song just about having fun and joy in the Lord. And we can trust him in these times and we can be joyful, okay? So especially if you have kids or something and you want to get up and dance a little bit or just clap your hands or just kind of tap your foot, we invite you to do that and just have a little fun with us, okay? Come on, ladies, you can put your hands together too. Come on. There is a river where goodness flows. There is a fountain that drowns sorrows. There is a ocean deeper than fear. The tide is rising, rising. There is a current stirring deep inside. It's overflowing from the heart of God. The flood of heaven crashing over us. The tide is rising, rising. Oh, we're bursting up from the ground. We feel it now. Bursting up from the ground. We feel it now. We come alive in the river. 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 There is a current stirring deep inside. It's overflowing from the heart of God. The flood of heaven crashing over us. The tide is rising, rising.
Sing bursting.
We're bursting, bursting up from the ground. We feel it now. Bursting, bursting up from the ground. We feel it now. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. Break open prison doors, set all the captives free. Spring up a well, spring up a well, spring up a well in me. Nothing can stop this joy, we're dancing in the streets. Spring up a well, spring up a well, spring up a well in me.
Sing it again.
Break open prison doors, set all the captives free. Spring up a well, spring up a well, spring up a well in me. Nothing can stop, nothing can stop this joy. We're dancing in the streets. Spring up a well. We come alive in the river. We come alive in the river. One more time. We come alive in the river. 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 We come alive in the river.
Hey, good morning. Pastor Steve here. We are so thankful that you've joined us for worship here this morning. You may be on your iPhone or laptop or iPad or television this morning, but any way that you've been able to join us is a good way. We are delighted that you're here with us. And I want to thank you on behalf of the staff just for your continued generosity. Your giving has been wonderful, and we've been able to do some really, really wonderful things in the community and through our mission work. And I wanted to just let you know that as a result of your benevolence, we've gotten some funds that we really want to designate to help our children as they go back into the school year. And we've got some extra money that we want to really load up with a lot of good school supplies for them. But the thing is, we need folks to help us shop for that. And so I hope that if you'd like to join us for that, that you'll give us a call at the office, or better still, take a look at the Here's What's Happening that we send out. And I think this went out on either Thursday afternoon or Friday. Take a look at that. And if you would like to help in that regard, we'd love to have your help. And there's a lot of things that we want you to be alerted to that are in the Here's What's Happening. So make sure you take a look at that. Thanks so much again for joining us this morning. Let's continue to worship together, shall we?
Psalm 90. O Lord our God, you have been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were born, before you gave birth to the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God. 1,000 years are like a single day to you, like the brief passing of an evening. Our lives to sweep away before us like a flood, or like the grass which sprouts new each morning. In the morning it flourishes, but by evening it fades and withers away. The span of our lives may reach 70 years, 80 years, perhaps more, yet too soon we are carried away as by the wind. Therefore, O God, teach us to live wisely and well. Teach us to be mindful in the living of our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Satisfy us every morning with your loving kindness, and let your favor be upon us forever. Give your approval to our work, O God. Confirm and give strength to the work of our hands.
This is what the prophet Jeremiah said. Listen, children of God, and all you who are in exile. The Lord God commands us to build houses and live in them, and plant gardens and eat their produce. Take wives and become the fathers of sons and daughters, and take wives for your sons and give your daughters to husbands, that they may bear sons and daughters, and multiply there, and do not decrease. And see the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile, and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will have welfare. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not for calamity, to give you a future and a hope. And then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart.
Good morning. I'm going to be reading from James 4:13 through 17. Today or tomorrow we will go to some city. We will stay there a year, do business, and make money. But you do not know what will happen tomorrow. Your life is like a mist. You can see it for a short time, but then it goes away. So you should say, if the Lord wants, we will live and do this or that. But now you are proud and you brag. All of this bragging is wrong. Anyone who knows the right thing to do but does not do it is sinning.
I put all my hope in the truth of your promise. And I steady my heart on the ground of your goodness. When I'm bowed down with sorrow, I will lift up your name. And the faults is in the vineyard will not steal my joy, because you are good to me, good to me. You are good to me, good to me. You are good to me.
Here's where my help is found. Hey there. Let me finish writing this one last check. I don't know about you, but we do most of our stuff online and auto pay and that sort of thing, but there are a couple of companies that just aren't quite set up to do that yet, right? Okay, all good. So last week we talked about sort of the big picture of what the Bible has to say about us and finances. This week, we're going to take a much more practical look at some practical biblical advice about personal finances. I don't know if you realize there are a lot of verses that go along that line. So don't tune out because we're talking about money on a Sunday. This is about how to help you in everyday life. And actually, we're going to start out with a little interview that I recorded this week with a couple of guys who know way more about money and finances than I ever will. So watch this.
Well, good morning. Thank you so much for taking some time to do this. For those of you out there who aren't familiar with these two cowboys, so Steve Mapp is with us. Steve is actually on our staff as Minister of Discipleship and Pastoral Care, but before that, had a long and wonderful career in the banking business in a whole variety of positions, and stepped out of that as a senior vice president. And Dee is still active, and he is an investment advisor primarily with companies and their retirement programs. Did I say that pretty accurately, guys?
Yes, sir.
Well, thank you so much. So, you know, I'm just a preacher. What do I know about money? And so I thought I would bring in a couple of guys who could give us some perspective. And so let me just kind of start with this question. And maybe, Steve, if I could start with you. What is it that you see that families need to do that they're just not doing? They don't ever get around to do that would really help them with their finances?
Well, Dave, it's been my experience over those years and personally to know that to me, the key ingredient is to have a plan, to have a budget, actually to sit down and, you know, with you or your spouse and actually formulate an accurate budget of the sources of whatever income you might have, as well as the uses of the funds. But it's just critically important to have it on paper and actually pay attention to it and monitor against it. You know, you just have to have a plan. And that's for personally, it's a budget. It's a personal financial budget for families. And it's critical in my mind. If you don't plan, you know, anything can happen. And that's not a good thing.
Dee, how would you pick up on that?
Well, I would certainly echo Steve's comments, but I would add to it that your plan and what you do needs to take into consideration the fact that you need to spend less than you make and save. You can have a budget plan and what have you, but if your expenditures are exceeding what you are making, that will not last very long. We are individually not able to handle our affairs the way our national government does. And I'm not sure that doesn't have an end point too, but that's a whole different conversation. But the key is at whatever stage of life you are, whether you're just getting started as a young person, a young couple, young family, moving into mid-career, and certainly as you get towards the time when you are going to retire, you have to have a financial picture that allows you to spend less than your income. That's
good. And just adding to that, David, real quick, we always need to be thinking long term. It's just, you know, your plan is yes for, you know, week to week, month to month, yes. Hopefully you've got monies left over at the end of each of those periods, but you've got to think long term because the future will get here. And if you're not prepared, it's going to be problematic, and that's tragic.
Sure. Well, and one of the beauties, though, of thinking long term is that then your money has that ability to grow and compound, and the power of that, I think most of us don't ever really realize. And if you go out and you can certainly find plenty of examples of how money grows if you start when you're young and you have a long term plan. It's unbelievable. So when you both of you guys talked about making a plan and making a budget, so is that something you do once a year and you're done? Is that something you need to do once a month? How often? Let's say it's a couple. How often should a couple sit down and kind of look at a budget?
I think a lot of that depends, David, on the timing of their income. I think, you know, I certainly would do it at least monthly, if not twice a month. But I also think that people should be talking about not only each month, but they ought to be looking a year ahead, 2 years ahead, 5 years ahead, and thinking about what they want things to look like then, and then setting that plan, making that plan a part of the plan that you're following each month. But it needs to be frequent.
I don't disagree with that. Need to have that plan, and you need to monitor it on a regular basis. I don't know that the plan itself needs to change unless circumstances change. But you have to be able to sit down and monitor the plan, monitor what you're actually doing, and do that on a regular basis, whether that's, you know, monthly, quarterly, you know, whatever works for you and your partner.
Sure. And, you know, just having the plan on the piece of paper is a great thing, but if you don't actually check and see if you're doing it,
right,
it's just a piece of decoration. So, all right. Well, is there anything that you see that couples are doing or individuals are doing that really is detrimental that you would advise people, you know, if you could grab somebody and say, hey, you really don't want to be doing that. Anything you would say to them?
The biggest thing for me is making sure that you're not using debt to support your operating expenses of running your life. Debt has an okay place in your long-term, near-term financial plans and future, but it needs to be for long-term assets that you are acquiring that are not depreciating in value, and that might put a car to the side of that, but most of us can't necessarily plunk down a bunch of cash for an automobile. But if you can, that would be a nice thing to be able to do. But managing credit card debt, anything debt that's acquiring an asset that depreciates in value, or at least doesn't hold in its value, is a mistake.
So debt for a house, certainly a very different category than debt for a new outfit that I saw down at the store.
Right. If you're buying your running shoes, David, on a credit card and you don't pay the credit card off, that's right.
I want to say that I, as a single, and my wife and I have just always had a policy. We pay off our credit card in full every month, and I have done that my entire life. I've never made an extra payment on a card. So if I couldn't afford it, I didn't put it on the card.
There you go.
And that's the right strategy. There's no question about it. But the thing, and I would echo what Dee has said about just the issue of debt. You know, debt literally chokes you from being able to be free with your money to let it do for you what you really want it to do for you, rather than making you do with it what it wants you to do. It's just tough. And so I would highly advise just to try to avoid certainly the credit card kinds of debts and things like that, that interest rates are high, and a lot of times we just lose sight of it. It can get out of control so quickly. And so you've really got to pay attention to the debt piece of this. Yeah.
I would add too, we use credit cards, but we use them as a matter of convenience.
Sure.
Because it's, you know, it's just easy to do. But when that bill comes in every month, it needs to be paid off as best you can. So,
you know, the other thing, David, I would say too, is for people to understand the importance of their credit scores and their credit reports. I mean, if you're not aware, that can really, it can hurt you for things that you really want to do, like a mortgage or buying a home or something like that. If you're not careful with your credit and managing it very well and keeping that credit score where it should be, that can turn out to be problematic.
Well, thank you guys so much, and I appreciate your wisdom and appreciate you taking just a few moments out of your day to do this. So you guys have a wonderful day, and we will see you later.
Thank you, David.
Thanks so much for having us. Okay, take care.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Well, thanks so much, Steve and Dee, and appreciate your taking your time and sharing your insights with us there. So I'm going to kind of walk through some Bible verses that give us some very specific help about how to handle our personal finances. I hope that you'll find this very practical and very helpful. Now, I'm going to write a few things on the board, and one of the things that you're going to discover today is that I have absolutely the worst handwriting in the world, and I'm just going to go ahead and do this anyway. Worst grades I ever got in school, penmanship. So here's number one. Have a plan. Have a financial plan. So earlier in the service, you heard those verses from James chapter 4, 13 to 17, where it talked about some guys who said, hey, in such and such time, we're going to go to this city and we're going to work and we're going to make a bunch of money. And it said, you really ought to have some humility about that, that none of us knows what's going to happen. And what we ought to say is, if God wills, we'll go do so and so. Now, one of the things we ought to take away with that is there's nothing wrong with having a plan. And in fact, we ought to have plans. We ought to have financial plans. We just need to make sure that they are always under God's will and we're living underneath what God wants us to do. But trust Him and make a plan. Proverbs 21:5 says, the plans of the diligent surely lead to profit. Those who are in a hurry rush toward poverty. So there was another individual that I had asked to be a part of this interview, and they were not able to participate. But we talked about the questions that I posed to Steve and Dee. And this person, who's a tax advisor, said something I thought was really insightful. They said, most people never stop and step back and really take a look at things. Take a look at their financial picture. Take a look at what it is that they're doing week in and week out, month in, month by month. And I thought that's really good, because it is so easy to get caught in this cycle of just rushing along from one paycheck to another, one bill to another, never really stopping to take a look, examine what's going on, and develop a plan. Just hurry through one paycheck period to the other. So that verse again says, the plans of the diligent lead to profit, but those who are in a hurry are just rushing to poverty. We all need a plan that is both A, long-term, and then B, what we need to do right now to move us towards that long term. And in fact, if you don't have a plan, all you really have are wishes. And it's probably not even really fair to say you have wishes. What you have are fantasies. So the most important step that you can take towards having a plan is this right here. Budget. You need to have a budget where you really write down on a piece of paper or put it all right there online, what's coming in, what's going out, what it's designated for, and you monitor it and you follow it. And actually what you do is you let that budget do the hard work for you. Luke chapter 14, starting in verse 28, says this: Suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Won't you first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough money to complete it? For if you lay the foundation and are not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule you, saying, this person began to build and wasn't able to finish. Now, this passage is, on the surface, it is about counting the cost of following Jesus. That's the primary topic there. But Jesus uses this principle of budgeting for a building project. And by using that, he's affirming this whole concept of looking ahead, estimating expenses, making concrete financial plans. In other words, having a budget. So I realize for some of us that just even saying this word, bringing it up, a budget, is just a turnoff. Well, you think of it as a ball and chain. It's so restricting. My budget won't let me do what I like to do, and things change all the time. I mean, you come up with all kinds of excuses about why a budget doesn't work for you. So one of the conversations I had this week was with Lance Mason. And Lance and Martha lead our Financial Peace University classes here at Winfrey. And he was talking about the importance of having a budget, just like Steve and Dee did. And he said, but because he works with just ordinary people like us in this financial planning process, and he said, what we discover, what other people discover, is that having a budget written down on paper is actually freeing. It's not constricting, it's freeing. It gives you permission to spend on the right things. Instead of always worrying about, okay, do I have enough money to do this? I don't know if I have enough money. A budget tells you that. So, this is what I urge you to do. This is one of your very practical applications out of this message. Today, if you don't have one, today, work on a budget and have it finished by this week. All right? Now, there are a lot of resources out there to help you. At the risk of somebody not liking it, that's fine. I'm going to mention one in particular, and it's called everydollar.com. And you can find it easily online. It's a free app, and I'm not recommending it per se. You may or may not like it. Just go look at it and see if it's something that would help you. Now, there are lots of others out there. Frankly, I tried. I looked at, I just simply Googled the words personal budget template, and all kinds of helpful things came up, Excel sheets and stuff you can print out on paper. If you like paper, that's fine. That's fine. All that is fine. But I just want to say to you, very frankly, don't procrastinate on this, okay? This week, all right? This week. So now what you want to use this budget to do is it's going to help you set priorities. It's going to help you set some priorities. Proverbs 24:27 says, this is a really interesting verse. Put your outdoor work in order and get your fields ready. After that, build your house. That's a really interesting verse, isn't it? I mean, basically it says, take care of your fields before you spend all of your time and your energy and your money on your house. Well, I mean, we need a place to live, right? So why this? Well, I think we can kind of see two things here. And so one is this. Taking care of the fields is not something that is just a part of your life. It is the means of survival. For a farmer, the crops are the very source of his livelihood. And so this verse is saying, focus first on the source of your livelihood and make that a higher priority than upgrading your TV room. Now, the second thing we see is this verse talks about the reality of priorities. We are going to set priorities. And those priorities are going to be clearly seen in how we spend our money, how we spend our time and energy, where we put our attention. And so in the process of using this budget to establish your priorities, let me encourage you to make biblical priorities. Biblical priorities. So I don't often say this, but let me encourage you, if you didn't listen to it, go back and check out last week's message, because that really talked about the reality that money and stuff and possessions or a car or whatever it is, that will never fill the hole in your life. That will never fill your deepest needs. It can't be your source of stability and what you lean on. Only God can fill those needs. So as you use this budget, then be sure that you're establishing biblical priorities, priorities about your whole life. Let me read a couple of verses to you. Proverbs 23, 4 and 5 says, "Do not wear yourself out to get rich. Do not trust your own cleverness. Cast but a glance at riches, and they're gone, for they will surely sprout wings and fly off to the sky like an eagle." Okay, anybody who had money in the stock market back in March, we felt like that, right? 1 Timothy 6:10, "For the love of money is the root of all kinds of evil." And we talked about that some last week. But look at the rest of this verse. "Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith." That's one thing that happens when we become consumed, when we don't have the right biblical priorities. "They wandered from the faith," and then listen to this, "and pierced themselves with many griefs." The result of being in love with money is not freedom and relaxation and comfort and security. It's being pierced with griefs. All right, so the first thing is have a plan. This is the second thing then. Number two, save. You need to save. Genesis chapter 41, starting in verse 34, says this. And this is Joseph talking to Pharaoh and helping interpret a dream that he had. "Let Pharaoh appoint commissioners over the land to take a fifth of the harvest of Egypt during the 7 years of abundance. They should collect all the food of these good years that are coming and store up the grain under the authority of Pharaoh to be kept in the cities for food. This food should be held in reserve for the country to be used during the 7 years of famine that will come upon Egypt so that the country may not be ruined by famine." So Joseph interprets this dream for Pharaoh, where God lets them know they're going to be 7 plentiful years and then 7 years of famine, and they need to save up from the good years for the bad years. Well, that seems pretty simple, doesn't it? But man, that can be so hard to do. I know that. So let me encourage you to sort of take 2 steps in this process. And the first one is to build an emergency fund. And the first baby step towards building an emergency fund is to build a fund where you have something like $500 to maybe $1,000. You pick that figure. But if you don't have this box checked, that's where you need to start. And this is really for those absolute instant emergencies that you have to be able to take care of. So that's like when the brakes go out on the car, or the tires go out and it won't pass inspection, or the refrigerator dies. You know, so I'm not talking about renovating the whole kitchen here. I'm just saying the refrigerator dies and we got to do something about that. And so you don't want to sink further into plastic debt to handle that kind of thing. Now, the other sense of an emergency fund is that the further you move into financial health, then you want to create an emergency fund that can handle those major disruptions of life, like a job loss or a major medical emergency. Now, most financial advisors talk about aiming at a target of something like 6 months of living expenses and having that set aside where it is in an accessible source. Don't lock that up in some investment because you never know when that emergency is going to hit, right? Like a pandemic that just suddenly comes and then you're in a jam. Proverbs chapter 6, verses 6 through 8 say this, "You lazy fool, look at the ant. Watch it closely. Let it teach you a thing or two. Nobody has to tell it what to do. All summer long, it stores up food, and at harvest, it stockpiles provisions." So you need to save first for an emergency fund, a real short-term one and then a bigger one. And the other thing is, you need to think long-term, and I so much appreciate the guys talking about that. Ecclesiastes 5, 13 and 14 says, "Here's a terrible thing that I've seen in the world. People hoard money to the point that it harms them, and some people lose their wealth through misfortune, and then they end up with nothing left to pass on to their children." Wow, so there's a great truth in the first part of this verse about people clutching on to more money than is good for them. But I want to focus on the second part that talks about thinking and planning long term. I mean, people are living longer than ever nowadays, right? A lot of us, we very honestly need to think about a retirement that might be 20 years or more. And so you need a plan that balances risk and reward and considers your long-term needs. None of us want to be a burden to our children, right? We want to be a blessing to our children. We want to be in the place where out of what is left out of an estate at the end of our life, we can be a blessing to our children or to other people. So you have to have a plan and you have to stick to it. And to achieve that plan, well, here's a verse that has some very practical financial advice. I didn't even know it was in the Bible until I started prepping for this message. It's Ecclesiastes 11, 12, and it says this, "Invest in 7 ventures." Yes, in 8. "You do not know what disaster may come upon the land." So as you save, you need to, just what you hear from the financial guys all the time, diversify your investments. Boy, that verse from Ecclesiastes, it's just a very short, clear explanation of why you ought to diversify. You never know what type of investment is going to fall victim to whatever evil it is that comes down the road. You know, back then it might have been a plague of locusts, but nowadays it's something that hits the stock market or it hits real estate. We've had all of those kinds of things. So, by diversifying your income, no single disaster hopefully will wipe you out. And there are a lot of wise folks who can help you do that kind of thing. It all just goes back to that old saying about don't put all your eggs in one basket, right? All right, so here is the third thing that we need to do. We need to avoid debt. Avoid debt. And yes, I put that in red on purpose. Proverbs 22:7 says, "The rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is a slave to the lender." Well, this proverb doesn't take a lot of skill to understand, right? It describes debt as a kind of slavery, and it is. Debt takes an incredible toll on people who carry it. It has both emotional, mental, physical results. There was an article in the magazine Health, the journal Health, that says high levels of debt are associated with anxiety, depression, relationship problems. It's linked to high blood pressure, lower immunity, physical symptoms like headaches, backaches, ulcers. Any of us who are in debt, you know all that. Debt is something that just enslaves you. Now, I do want to give a little bit of pastoral perspective about debt. And it's a perspective sometimes that just breaks my heart. Living in debt can close doors that God would otherwise have you go through in your life. I've seen people who wanted to become missionaries, and they were not able to until they took care of some oppressive debt. There are people who want to go to seminary and prepare for ministry, and they weren't able to because of debt. There are people who sometimes want to go on a mission trip, or they wanted to go to a Christian conference, and they're not able to because of debt. And sometimes people want to just simply help somebody else in need. They want to give to their church. They want to support a child overseas, and they're not able to do that because of the enslaving debt in their life. So don't let debt become such an obstacle in your life that you're not able to do the wonderful things that you would love to do. All right, finally, here's number four. Let me just talk about that very briefly. And that is that we need to give. We all need to give. It ought to be a part of our financial plan. Our Heavenly Father is incredibly generous, and as we become more like Jesus, then we ought to reflect God's generosity. And sometimes when God gives us a surplus, it's just sort of our first instinct to either use it for ourselves or use it to create a bigger cushion and think that that's our security or indulge ourselves in some kind of way. And I just want to encourage you to ask God for guidance when this kind of things happen and check your motives. And so, A, include giving in this plan that you create. Make it part of your biblical priorities. And start at whatever level that you can, but then A, include it in your plan, but B, in your plan, in your real long-range plan, have a plan to grow your giving. As God blesses you, as you move into a position of greater financial health, then let God bless you. Let God bless others through you more and more. So have a plan that next year you're going to give more than you were able to give this year. So I realize that this is a very different kind of message, and you know, maybe it's not filled with some warm, gushy story about forgiveness or love. But actually, this is about love. This is about some of the most powerful things that you can do to demonstrate love to your spouse, to your children, to your parents, to other people that are around you. And the Bible is full of verses about practical guidance for your personal finances. So I want to urge you again to not just simply listen to this, but to take those practical steps that support these biblical truths. Make a budget. Start today. Finish it this week. And then there might be this one other thing. Sometimes there's some real value in being a part of a class where you learn and you kind of get a better handle on all this kind of thing. There's often some real help and real encouragement from others all kind of going through this process together. So we periodically offer a Financial Peace University class. We were actually offering it when this whole COVID thing began. And the church and Lance and Martha Mason, and we hope to be able to start one again soon. So let me encourage you, if you have any interest in being a part of a class like that, then either go out to the Financial Peace website, or even better, email the church and we'll put you on a list. And as soon as we're ready to be able to get something like that going, we'll let you know and see if that's a good time for you. All right, let's pray together. Father, this is just a very practical part of our life, how we handle the money that you've put in our hands. And we understand it can be an incredible blessing, or if we don't do this right, it becomes a weight. It becomes a shackle. And we don't want to do that. We want to be free to follow you and to bless other people's lives. So, Father, help us to take these very practical actions. In all this, we ask in your name. Amen. Thank you so much. And let's sing another song.
Thanks again for joining us this morning for worship. It is really wonderful when we have everyone together worshiping with us. We're just so encouraged by all that. And so by way of benediction, let me encourage us all as we depart this morning together to go into the world in peace. May we always be of good courage. Can we strengthen the weak? Can we comfort the downhearted? Can we be patient with one another, never repaying evil for evil? And may we find ways to just share Christ's love in the world. Thanks again. Have a great week. God bless you.